When people are having that much fun, I always suspect there must be something illegal going on. I always thought everything I liked was either illegal, immoral, or fattening. Or all three. As we go through the Inner Light Consciousness series, what we find is that, as Carrie was pointing them out on a list up here, they don't quite unfold as steps on a list. Every workshop is contained within the workshop before it and flowers in the workshop after it. So they're overlapping from the very first workshop through the second, through the third, and so on, right down through the 12 workshops. We should make a note that the 13th workshop is residential. It is not a part of this series. It is something that you have to apply for. You may or may not be accepted. And it's a concentrated intensive, and it ain't easy. But all the rest of them are. So you have 12 fun workshops to do, and then the 13th is a challenge. And some have already discovered that the first three or four are a challenge. I heard all the gossip. This one is on relationships, and when you do a workshop in relationships, you're doing a workshop on life, because the way that we know that we're alive is that we relate. Relating is what life is about. You have a relationship with yourself. You have a relationship with your source. You have a relationship with everyone that you know. You have relationships with objects. You have a relationship with the earth. You have relationships with concepts. And as you go through those things, maybe we ought to start at the bottom with concepts. How's your relationship with concepts? Good? You have a good relationship with concepts? Go ahead, commit yourself before I tell you what I'm going to ask you next. Concepts. All right, what concepts? Well, how about Catholicism? All right, somebody has a problem in relationships with a concept here. How about fundamentalism of any stripe? Muslim, Christian, Judaism, fundamentalism. You have a good relationship with the concepts? Okay. Linda can handle a concept, but doesn't handle the people very well. Well, maybe we believe that people who have that belief are obnoxious. Is it the people who are obnoxious, or does the belief make them obnoxious? Well, maybe we'll find out this weekend, because we're going to look at how relationships work. There are two things, I think, that are pieces of gold, or maybe diamonds is a better word, crystal clear, I hope, in Inner Light Consciousness, that are the way the mind works. You'll see that in Talk to Yourself workshop, and the way relationships work. And what you're going to find when you look at relationships is that yours are not unique. The problems that you have in relationships and the way your relationships unfold, you're going to find are surprisingly predictable in this workshop. If you don't find that they're surprisingly predictable, you didn't understand the workshop. I thought that was funny. It's terrible when people don't laugh at your jokes. I mean, you laughed at Carrie. No, we laughed with you, Carrie. Oh, don't say that. She's cute. I'm not. You guys are getting sharp. Within relationships, in the implication of this relationship workshop, also comes sexuality. So we're going to be talking about relationships and sexuality. And I want to just set you up for this one by saying to all of you men, there are things about women that you don't know. And there are some women in this group who would like you to find out. Ladies, there are some things you don't know about men. And there are some men here who do not want you to find out. But we're going to give away secrets from both sides of the fence. So look forward to this workshop. This guy is hoping it's participatory. That's why he's grinning that way. What I want to tell you about this workshop is that from some seed thoughts that we planted quite a long time ago, Thomas took these seed thoughts, watered them, developed them, tried them, applied them, got feedback on them, and created a great deal of what this workshop is and the way that it unfolds. I don't want to step on his presentation, so I'm not going to tell you the phases of a relationship. But I will tell you, if you think your relationship does not develop through these phases, you miss something. When you hear these phases, just tick them off. You have gone through them, and for you who do not have a working relationship right now, Thomas is going to tell you why. And he's going to tell you what to do about it next time, so you better listen. If you're not in a wonderful relationship, but you're looking forward to being in one, you better take notes, because you are going to go through these phases, and each one of them has a pitfall. Each stage has its pitfall. If you can identify the stage and know what the pitfall is, you can step around it. And you can move from phase to phase without hurting. You know that more people get hurt in relationships with other people than in any other way, including war and all the rest of it. There's even a saying that says you always hurt the one you love. Do you believe that? Okay, listen to phase two and find out how not to. There's a good reason not to hurt the ones you love, and there's a reason why we do. If you always hurt the one you love, listen carefully to phase two and find out how not to. Now, if people you love are always hurting you, listen to phase five and find out what you do to get the relationship unstuck again and get back to the renewal of love, transformation in relationships. That's where we're heading for by Sunday evening. How to get your relationship into transformational love. That's the last phase of this workshop. I'm going to just do that much to introduce Thomas Keller to you and to tell you he has shared this workshop in several different countries, several different cities, at a couple of family gatherings. Every time he's done this workshop, people have been so enthusiastic that this has established Thomas's self-confidence, his charisma, and eventually it's going to teach him good grammar. Until then, you have to be satisfied with his charm. Okay, Thomas, that's the best I can do.
as Paul started out sharing with us, life is relating, okay? And I like to say that Paul gave a lot of the examples, and I like to even go farther with that as far as we have a relationship with our clothes. This is one I watch my wife go. I keep it simple. I have white shirts, gray pants, and blue pants. My wife has got this closet full of clothes, and it's fascinating to watch. See if you can identify with this male or female. How many times I've watched her get up in the morning, put on an outfit, go around the house, and the next thing I realize, she's back in the room changing the outfit because it doesn't feel right. You with me? Okay? The relationship we have. So life is relating, and life tells us how alive we are. All right? It tells us how alive we are. So we use our relationships for self-identity and for how alive we are, negatively and positively. Sometimes we get our aliveness by being very positive with each other, but if we don't get it from a positive scenario, then we are willing to get it from a negative one, but we are going to relate with each other one way or another. Okay? Divorce. Is that a way of ending a relationship, or is it a way of relating? Is everybody with me on that? When I do the relationship workshop and when I do counseling with couples, I always share with a couple, if you're having problems in your relationship and the stuff is really flying, this is not the time to get a divorce. This is the time to work out what isn't working. And when the relationship is working perfectly and you can find nothing to work on, that's the time for a divorce if you want one. The relationship has taught you what it's going to teach you. But you don't want to get, to me, it's like going to college for 8 years for a master's degree, getting to the final exam, and dropping out. Is everybody with me on the principle I'm trying to share? When the relationship isn't working, that's the time to get involved and find out why it's not going the way you want it to go. It's not the time to bail out. We get married for better or worse, but not for long. Until divorce do we part. Yes. What if?
Yeah.
Okay.
What if at that point in the relationship you just came to the realization that you shouldn't have gotten into the relationship in the first place? Yeah. And that's why you're getting a divorce.
That's the point to be made. You know, when I share that point, I am not, the first thing that comes up is a lot of people who have already been divorced or they're in the middle of a divorce. That's not exactly the point. However, I will say that any two people who want to relate happily can. Any two people, agreed. And I believe there probably are times when we get in a relationship and it's probably not the relationship that we want to stay in. And at the same time, I still want to say that there is potential for learning a lot. I believe relationships is a major teaching tool that we all work with, the major one. So what the one thing I suggest to couples, and this has now become a part of the fellowship, it came from Paul, that if you want to be married in the fellowship, we ask that you do a marathon. Is everybody in here familiar somewhat with the marathon experience? The 48-hour marathon. What I do with couples who come to me who want to talk about divorce is I tell them, I am willing to help you get out of this marriage as easily as possible if you will do a marathon on separating. You with me? The whole key that I'm approaching is working with it and finding out what there is to learn. Because in this workshop, one of the things we're going to look at closely tomorrow is we create our opportunities to work out unfinished business in relating. And this is one for the Hall of Records or one for your notes. I create the opportunities I need to work out unfinished business in relating. I create it myself, not Mariana. She doesn't create the business that I need to work out. I create it. So I choose a partner, and this is a part of tomorrow's, how we pick our partners. And you may find that to be one of the most interesting parts of the workshop. Because we know how you pick your partners. And it's the same way we picked ours. Okay? The workshop will show you how we pick our partners and why we pick the partners we pick. So relating, we create the opportunity. And one of the points I want to share right now that I feel very strongly about, and that is to clear up a little metaphysical New Age jargon, and that is I have a karmic relationship. This is a karmic relationship. And as soon as Mariana learns her karma, we're going to be happy. As soon as Mariana works out her karma, then this karmic relationship is going to be more fun for me. And for years I wrestled with that, and finally in a Paul Solomon reading, and I will read the reading to you tomorrow or Sunday, the source cleared up a point that I've always really believed in, and that is all karma is with ourselves. And we pay all karmic debt. No one's going to pay a karmic debt for Thomas. No one's going to pay a karmic debt for one of you. Your partners don't pay your karmic debts. You may have the ideal partner so you can find out what your karma is. Did everybody get that one? You may have the ideal partner to show you what your karma is, but it's ours. It's our lesson, our opportunity to complete unfinished business, our opportunity to work it out. So every relationship is an opportunity to extend our love. This is another one for the Hall of Records or your notes. Every relationship is an opportunity to extend our love. Everyone, the clerk at the 7-Eleven store, your partner in this program, the person who's not your partner, one of the staff members, every relationship in any given moment of the day is an opportunity to extend love, to extend our true identity to the other person. Okay? So we have, this is another one of the major principles for this workshop, the one-liners. Every relationship is an opportunity to extend love. Every time we are encountered or we encounter another person, we have an opportunity to extend love. Or as Paul was saying, this also applies to concepts, principles, ideas, so on and so forth. This workshop is not specifically designed for couples. It's a workshop that works very well if you're in a relationship. I won't ask you to raise your hands, but if you're in a relationship and you have one of those partners who doesn't want to go to relationship workshops, this is the ideal workshop for you. It's perfect because your partner does not need to be here for you to get the workshop and to have it affect the relationship. Okay? It's an important point. Your partner does not have to be here for you to get this workshop and for it to have an effect on your relationship. We are also going to be looking at, so you can keep track of this, not just relationships with people. As Paul said, all relationships unfold. So this can be your relationship with a person. And now in the last time I did this workshop, some lady raised her hand and said, but I'm going to work out all of my unfinished business with God. I don't want any more partners. It's me and God now. And I told her, you're in the right workshop because your relationship with God is going to unfold in phases, and it's going to be the same scenario for you. So that works too. Okay? But what I also want to be able to look at during the weekend is we're also going to be looking at relationships with money, relationships with careers, relationships with starting businesses. And you will discover that all relationships unfold through these phases. It can be a person, a place, or a thing. If it is important to you, if it matters in your life, it will start to unfold through the phases. Okay? The other point that we're going to cover this weekend that will come up later tomorrow is we're going to talk about forgiveness. How forgiveness works in relationships, how it doesn't work in relationships, and who forgiveness is for. All right? Working with forgiveness and who it's for, and how to get forgiveness to work for us to get the results that we're looking for when we have a situation with forgiveness. I don't want to go too far into the phases tonight because it'll start to unfold tomorrow, but we'll start with a couple of them. And the first phase of a relationship is called the romantic phase. Tom.
You're talking about men and women. This is, can you have a romance with a concept?
Yes, absolutely. Okay. Good point. I'm glad you brought that up to restate that. The first phase we're going to talk about is romantic phase. Now, you can have romantic phase, obviously, with another person. You can have it with God. You can have your first spiritual experience and hit romantic phase with God. You can do it with money. You can do it with a new career. And I will show you how I discovered the validity of these phases one day when I was sitting down meditating on this. And I got to thinking, if these phases are as valid as I'm thinking they are, they have to apply to everything across the board. Everything. Not just people, not just God, not just money. So,
you want to tell her what relationship that was? That you
realized? Yeah. It was with my computer. I bought a computer because I had a lot of work to do. I wanted to write some books. I wanted to do some outlines. I wanted to rewrite a book I've already written. And the conclusion was I needed a computer. And that was the first phase with my computer, was romantic phase. Now, relate this to your partner if you want, but you know the phase to where you pace around the house and you can't go anywhere, and I call Steve and I tell him I can't come to the office today because I'm waiting for my computer. And it's supposed to arrive today, and you wait, and you wait, and you wait. And it's supposed to be there 10, and it's supposed to be there 11, it's supposed to be there 12. Finally, Federal Express shows up at 2, you know, and you can't wait to get the guy out the door so you can rip into these boxes and get this computer set up because of what it's going to do for me. All the things that are going to happen now that I have this computer, okay? Well, there is a phase that comes later that's called power struggle. I hit power struggle with my computer when I didn't have any outlines. I had no books. I didn't rewrite any of them. The computer did not do what I thought it was going to do. Okay? I'm very serious about this. I literally went through these phases with the computer, and that's when I realized this is pure gold. This is, you know what romantic phase is. You know, number one, it's an altered state of consciousness. The romantic love phase, Hall of Records now, or in your notes, is an altered state of consciousness. That's the most important point to remember. It is an altered state of consciousness. You'll buy an $1,800 computer when if you would have waited one more day, you could have got the same computer for $1,200, but you can't wait. It's an altered state of consciousness. You'll make decisions that you'll wish later you wouldn't have made. All right? If you're doing this with a partner, it's an altered state of consciousness, which means you're going to say and do things that you are definitely going to regret later. Should I repeat that? In romantic phase, you will say and do things that you will regret later. One of the things you'll do is you'll tell your partner where every one of your buttons are because you are so in love they would never push one. I mean, we are so in love, and this is a karmic relationship, by the way. It's meant to be. God told me this is my soulmate, so I can obviously reveal all of me. And this button causes this, and this button will do that, and this one will do, you push this one, we'll get a divorce. You know, but here they are. Here's my buttons. Altered state of consciousness, you know. I need less sleep. I need less food. Does everybody remember that?
That's where we're going. It says, what did you do when you were frustrated? Isolate yourself, run away from home, pout, cry, scream, fight back, yell louder, hit harder. What did I do when I was frustrated as a child? Well, being kept from doing something could cause you to feel frustrated, yes. But what did I do when I was frustrated as a child? What did I do?
From the time I was about 13 on, I searched for love in my dad in all the wrong places, that being men.
Okay. When I'm frustrated, I look in the wrong places. Okay.
I broke the rules. I went out of bounds when I wasn't supposed to. You know, okay. Just physical.
Right.
Smoked.
Smoked? So I break rules when I'm frustrated.
Not now, but then.
Right.
Stole from the Catholic Church.
All right.
Yeah. I wet my pants.
All right.
Oh, right.
Which is a real interesting one. Yes. That's a, wetting the pants is a real interesting one for children. It's one thing you cannot stop a child from doing. It's fascinating.
My nose would bleed.
Okay.
I would get very, very ill and hallucinate.
I would hurt myself physically.
I took sides against my twin sister.
Okay. I would take sides and I would hurt myself. Hurting of self when frustrated as a child is almost universal. Now, I'm not telling you all that you have to put that down on the paper. I am telling you, look closely at childhood. You will probably discover that hurting of self and breaking things is very universal. Extremely so. I want to give you a couple more real universal answers you may want to have on your paper. Refuse to heal it. Refuse to deal with it. You with me? Do you remember as a child when you're upset or frustrated with your parents? You are not going to let them help you resolve it, at least for a certain period of time. I will not let you help me heal this. I want to stay in my pain. Does everybody get the principle I'm trying to share? Right. Okay, sometimes we refuse the solution for a period of time. Yes.
Yeah, this reminds me of my little juvenile delinquent phase when I was 13 or 14. I was vengeful and angry.
Right.
And bent on being the, you know, what I look at now is kind of a pissant, but it made me feel real good.
Mm-hmm. Revengeful, angry are very good ones. Responses to frustration.
I would take my bike and pedal it all out on the pedals.
Exhaust myself.
Yeah. Not come home for at least an hour and a half, 2 hours. And I realized by saying that I do it now in the car.
Very good. Don't get ahead of me.
To manipulate my parents when they
manipulate.
Fought.
When frustrated, I manipulate.
I would walk out on them and
all
say,
right.
Never come back.
Yeah. Everybody get this. I use threats when I'm frustrated.
Mm.
That's a threat. And that's what he would put on his paper. I use threats when I'm frustrated. Threaten my parents, threaten my brothers or sisters.
I wouldn't still do slam things around and growl.
Yeah, slam things, break things.
I used to want to make them pay, and I often wished I'd
get revenge.
Yeah, I wished I'd died, so then they'd be sorry.
Get revenge. I'm going to make you pay.
I'm not exactly sure how to phrase this, but I remember transferring dependencies away from the family that I couldn't meet myself, away from the family onto a girlfriend. And
I would cut them off, is one way I would phrase it. Transferring the dependency, I'll cut you off if you frustrate me. Or I'll try to isolate you. Hmm?
Abandonment.
I would determine that I was not going to feel it. I was not going to, it was not going to get in.
Shut down my feeling body.
I started reading a lot.
Okay. Reading a lot, which would be isolate yourself or withdrawing. Yes. Tom. Oh, no, that's okay. Go ahead if you got it.
I guess I learned to play the game. I play the role.
Okay. I would placate is what I would put down. I would placate when I was frustrated.
Retreat into imagination.
Okay. That's escape.
I was not, as I said, not allowed to show negative emotions. So my frustrations were mostly with my parents.
Mm-hmm.
So aside from escaping into fantasy or girlfriend's house or something like that, since we couldn't like scream, break things, or slam the door, or do anything like that, I bit my pillow a lot.
Okay. Beat my pillow.
I would do the obvious that seemed masturbate.
I used to act real cynical and or talk real cynical and smart aleck.
Okay. Mm. Cynical and smart aleck.
I would do exactly what they told me not to do. I can still remember.
Defiant.
Marilyn, you can't go to drive-ins because if you go to drive-ins, you'll get in trouble. And by God, every time I went in on a date, I hit it for a drive-in.
So I'd be defiant.
Know. Yeah, it was very defiant.
Defiant. That's probably a universal answer for all of us.
I didn't get into trouble.
Being defiant.
We used to fight a lot. Well, I remember
fight.
Throwing rocks at each other.
Just fight.
Fight.
Rocks. At your parents?
No, not my parents. The playmates. No, I wouldn't do that. The playmates. Fight with my playmates.
Okay. I would fight when I was frustrated.
I ran away from home when I was 16, and I wouldn't come back unless they would let me out until about, I think it's one or two.
Running away from home. All right. Well, another real universal one that maybe most of you have is most of us also lie when we're frustrated. And that's a little bit of what you were saying there as I heard it. I'll go to the drive-in and let you think something happened, you know, revenge. Yeah. Lying in revenge, yeah.
My twin sister sucked her thumb.
Okay.
I think she was frustrated.
You got one? Or you got the mic? Okay. Does everybody feel like they've got a good amount of answers for this one? What did I do when I was frustrated? Okay, let's take that, everybody. Okay. Okay, while we're...
Have no fear for Joseph.
While we're waiting for... I need everybody to get back before we start the next session. So I want to... Let me clarify some things that I'm hearing coming out of part of this morning's workshop. When I talk about not reliving things, I am not suggesting that we don't deal with painful childhood scenarios. My point is this: don't work on trauma from your childhood. Work through it. Are you with me on that? Don't spend time working on it. Work through it. That's my point. If you work on it, it will be there tomorrow. It will be there the next day. It will be there as long as you're working on it. You'll get rid of it when you go through it. Yes?
Thomas, what do you mean with that? What do you mean exactly? How can you work out? How can you work through it? I mean, exactly what do you mean?
Well, working through it boils down to changing your mind about it. All right? And changing your perception of it, and therefore changing the result you believe it produced in your life. All right? So it is a matter of changing your mind about the situation or changing your perception of the situation and moving on through it instead of working on it. I believe the same thing about marriages. I don't believe there's any value in working on your relationship. Work with it wherever it may be at any given moment.
Thomas, I was a master daydreamer. I don't, from this perspective, consider that escape, but would you mind commenting on that?
Well, the comment I would give on that is this. I don't believe you can escape from reality. You can go from one reality to another. You can avoid certain realities, using the word maybe loosely. I don't consider it to be an escape. You following me? You can't escape what is. You can avoid what is. You can deny what is. You can lie about what is. You cannot escape it. So I don't know that you can do that. When I was heavy into drug addiction, they called it an escape from reality. And I was talking to a psychiatrist in the Army, and he was telling me that when I took hallucinogenics, I was escaping from reality. And I was trying to explain to him how real an hallucinogenic trip is. So I said, I don't quite agree that this is an escape. It may be an escape from the reality you're in, but take one of these, and you'll know the reality I'm in. Yes. Yes. Yes.
One of the greatest modern philosophers was James Thurber, always worth reading. One of his things is called The Case for the Daydreamer. And he makes the point that if you think about, you know, what you might have done in a certain situation, you might have done a very clever thing and so on, and you imagine it, and that's very well. And it's better that way than if you actually had done it, because you might have really gotten clobbered if you had, you see.
Mm-hmm.
But by just thinking about it, then it's safe and you can be happy.
Okay. All right, if we've got everybody, go back to your first page. Which is, the page I want you to be on now is the one that says, list all the negative characteristics of the people who raised you. Okay? And in the part of the paper that says the statement, which is above the answers, write down there, I am looking for a person who is. This is the negative characteristics. I am looking for a person who is. On the page that has the question, the negative characteristics, where it says statement, write, I am looking for a person who is. The first page, negative characteristics. Okay? Go to the second page, the one that talks about positive characteristics. In the statement I would like you to write down is, in order to get them to be. In order to get them to be. You with me? In order to get them to be, and then put a parenthesis, and inside the parenthesis put with me. On the third page, one that talks about, think about what you wanted and needed most as a child, your heart's desire. Write the phrase or the statement, so that I can get. So that I can get. And page four, or think about positive memories of childhood. Write the phrase, and feel. And feel. Some of you are getting the picture. On the last page, the one about frustrations, write the phrase, I stop myself from getting this sometimes by. I stop myself from getting this sometimes by. Are we getting the picture of how we pick our partners? What we've just done is a little exercise that tells us how we pick our partners. And let me see how well I can explain this to you on how this works. Number one, your partner, you may look at this and say, but wait a minute, Thomas, my partner doesn't quite fit this. There's three ways we deal with it. We pick a partner who does fit what's on these five pages. Or we project that our partner fits what's on these pages. And the most likely one, actually it's all three, most likely, unless you were not lucky enough to get a partner who does fit all this. And the last one, which is very common, and this is interesting, most people deny this when I share it, you can see it in a relationship so clearly, we provoke our partner until they do fit it. We provoke our partner until they do. Okay? Now, the principle we're working with around all of this is this. Our true nature is love. Love is our true identity. And from earliest childhood, there is a desire to be that which we are. Is everybody with me so far? We want to be our true identity, our true nature, which is an expression of love. As we grow up, we get, for lack of a better word, wounded, scarred, or split
with these negative, positive characteristics of caretakers. And what we have going on in our life, not our caretaker's life, remember, we're dealing with self. What happens to Thomas when Thomas has a negative reaction to a catalyst outside of Thomas? Thomas has unfinished business with that catalyst, not the person, the trigger. The unfinished business is simply this: I did not respond with love. Is everybody with me? I shared last night and I shared today, we create the opportunity to complete the unfinished business. We are attracted to people who will role model to us what our caretakers role modeled, so we have the opportunity to respond with love. Does this make sense to everybody? Okay? We are attracted to people who can role model to us any areas of unfinished business as a child, so we can finish it. The finishing of the business is a response of love. We are attracted to people who can role model to us our unfinished business, because we want an opportunity to respond with love. This is why some people go in and out of dysfunctional relationships over and over again, and their therapist says, why are you attracted to that man or woman again? Because the person has unfinished business, which is a love response. The other side of this coin that I am trying to share is this. Your partner is the one person in your life who is capable of calling you back to wholeness. You with me? The very person you thought was causing you a lot of pain in your life is the same person, if you will respond to them with love, who can call you back to the real you. It makes your partner pure gold. Pure gold. If you will respond to everything your partner does with love, your partner will call you back to wholeness. If you react, you will experience a lot of pain. The only part about this workshop, when we get to this point, that is frustrating for me is it's so simple, I don't quite know how to complicate this sufficiently enough to get it across. Your partner is pure gold. Especially if they are causing you pain as you're looking at it. Because if you will stop that and respond with love, they will call you back to the Christed being that you are. Okay? Yes.
I'm really excited. Okay, I keep telling you how much I enjoy it when you speak. But it's so clear to me what you're saying. It's so really clear. I look at the first marriage. I'm looking for an unloving, non-supportive, abusive, you know, super critical. And the negative person that I was with, the one that I didn't have my heart involved with, that first marriage, I learned a lot of lessons. And, you know, I found that easier because I found it easier to be in an abusive situation than in a non-abusive situation. And I really believe that there are many things I did learn to respond to with love. Mm-hmm. And those things got crossed out. But there were some leftovers. Now I'm in a relationship with somebody I love, and my heart's engaged. So there are still places, even though he's not an abusive person, there are still places where I'll provoke, do everything, mm-hmm. so I can feel criticized and rejected, because that's what I'm comfortable with. So I'll work on that. But those are still unfinished business.
Right.
I mean, you are just describing the progression in relationships mm-hmm. with myself, which... I'm just very impressed, and I just agree with everything you said. feel it so clearly, and it's so easy. It is so easy, because it was so easy for me to respond to an unloving situation with love, because first of all, that martyred me, and mm-hmm. I could get into that. But learning to respond to love with what's left over. And really, this is grace, because the first relationship was much more karmic.
Right.
This relationship still has its I mean, I still, I have, I'm not completed. So, but I still consider it learning under grace in this situation because the heart is involved and it's
right.
It's a more pleasant atmosphere. But I'm
the path of the heart is the law of grace.
I just feel what you said is just down the line description of what I'm doing. Thank you very much.
Great, thank you. Your partner can call you back to wholeness if you respond with love. We need a mic back here. Unfinished business is any scenario I reacted to instead of responded with love to.
First, I'll have to ask you what you mean by call you back to wholeness. Do you mean change you to a different sort of person, or have you fulfilled your natural, you know?
Have you fulfilled your natural expression?
Suppose my natural nature is to be a disgusting slob, and the partner cannot put up with a disgusting slob. How will
that may be the nature of your personality and character. It's not the nature of the real you.
But you know, it does mean you would have to change then.
Well, from the
you have to be fixed according to the way the other person wants to fix you.
Well, that's not what we're talking about here. We're again at this point in the workshop. We're only dealing with ourselves. And do I react or do I respond with love? And I'm only talking about the partner to point out to you how important and how special your partner is.
But by responding with love, it means changing and getting rid of these characteristics which are unacceptable to the other person, right?
I don't know if it means that. It means responding with love.
I mean, how difficult that may be, that may be what's necessary.
Yes.
In order to respond with love. Okay.
Yes.
I have to echo what Susan said. I married a man that brought up my deepest fear, and I absolutely had to face my horror of abandonment because I married somebody who was running all over the country having lots of friends and it had many, many, many relationships. And I had to just face absolute terror.
Mm-hmm.
And I've come a long way through that. And I'm real grateful for it. It still frightens me sometimes, and I'm still working through it, but it really has been a tremendous gift to my life.
Right. He's as you respond to love, he's calling you back to your wholeness.
Right.
Maybe even, a lot of partners do it unconsciously, by the way. I'm not saying that your partner is your teacher and knows your soul lessons. I am saying they will naturally call you back into wholeness if you respond with love. And do what you are disinclined to do. So there was probably a time when you were inclined to be jealous and would not get out of it, you see?
Yeah.
Exactly.
Right. But now, what I've learned through all of it, and I'm still learning, is to value the way he is, the way he appreciates people and loves to be with them and learns from them. I've just learned so much through all of this. Mm-hmm. It's been a wonderful experience and a very painful one, too.
Yeah. There's a magical thing about what we're doing this afternoon in this workshop. If you're hearing these principles and you're willing to work on yourself, which is to do what you are disinclined to do, there's something fascinating that's going to happen. I can guarantee you this if you do it. Now, I said earlier, half measures avail nothing. If you will do it, you'll come back to me in 6 months and tell me how much your partner has changed. And I'll tell you it is not your partner who changed. It's you. You see? I used to be extremely jealous myself, very jealous husband, of Marianne flirting. And then I realized Marianne doesn't flirt anymore. And then I realized maybe she never did. And then I realized, well, maybe she still is. Are you with me? When I dealt with Thomas, I dealt with what I thought was Marianne's problem. You see? And to this day, I don't know if she does or not, because it's not important anymore. Yes?
Thomas, how can you, how do you put it that, you know, you're dealing with your own stuff? If you have a mate that's out running around on you, you know, going with other people, you're not going to respond with love. I mean, you're just not going to do that.
You can choose not to. It's a choice. It's a preference.
I mean, that really deeply hurts. It hurts anyone.
I'm not saying it doesn't. I will say how much it hurts, how long it hurts, is only your choice.
You're hurting another human being. You shouldn't be married.
You're giving another. If you have a partner running around on you, you have a partner giving you an opportunity to be whole or to be hurt. The choice is yours, not your partner's.
Be whole when he's out.
True. Yeah. Yes.
I would like you to, how would you apply this to the situation that Susan brought up earlier about the marriage of an older woman whose husband had died, and from the outside perspective, it appeared that he was verbally abusive to her, but yet to her, she had responded that it was a great marriage, mm-hmm. It was a great relationship. Was she just responding with love or what?
I'm not sure. She may have been responding with love. She may have been responding with a lack of acceptance of what was really going on. Could be a thousand things. Again, this is why this workshop was specifically designed to not deal with your partner. It is designed to deal with self. However, I can tell you another point, and you can throw up an argument, but do hear this. If you start responding to every situation with love in your relationship, your partner is going to follow. I can guarantee it. It's going to catch on. It may take a little while, but it will catch on. I can guarantee you that. If you're willing to be consistent and you're willing to work at it and do what you are disinclined to do and start responding with love to what you think is your partner hurting you, your partner will cooperate after a short period of time. Or they'll leave, one or the other. And if they leave, it wasn't a marriage anyway.
So does it basically come down to learning how to love yourself?
It comes down to loving self and then expressing that love. Or being the love that we are is the way I like to say it. Yes.
When we talk about this, Thomas, does it also incorporate drawing boundaries and as far as what you will tolerate in a relationship when you're responding with love? It seems to me that self-love also has to be a part of it and that you have to make your position clear. Is mm-hmm. that a loving way to do it? You know, I'm trying to get a grasp on exactly when you say respond with love, what exactly goes into that, and can it incorporate drawing boundaries? Yeah. And
yes, I believe it can. I'm obviously putting the goal way up here, and some people say, Thomas, your goal's too high, and I'm saying reach for it. Respond to every situation with love. The point I'm making is if there's anything anybody can do that I believe is causing me pain, I need to heal that. I need to heal it. And the way I heal it is to respond to it with love. Now, at the same time, I would agree that a couple can come together and get very honest, clear, if they know how to communicate with each other and know what the boundaries are in the relationship. However, if those boundaries appear to be conditional love, the partner has no choice but to break the boundaries to find out if the love is real. Does everybody get that? Mm-hmm. If it appears to be a conditional boundary, know that your partner is going to cross it. Mm. They really don't have a choice from one perspective. They have to find out if this love is real.
Because it takes their freedom away.
Exactly.
And they're going to have to find out if the love is freely given.
If it's freely given, there will be no boundaries. You know, in my marriage, I lived from the time we got married for years, my greatest fear was an affair. I was extremely jealous. I was all of those things. I was confronted with my greatest fear. I wrestled with the lesson for 6 months. When I went through it, I realized I could have gone through it the day I found out about it. Why I drug it around for 6 months, I still don't know. And there's an interesting thing about going through the lesson. And I don't mean giving up on it, getting complacent about it, acting as if I don't care. Getting through the lesson did a fascinating thing for my marriage. I have not had the fear or the worry or the concern or the doubt, and I trust her more now than I did before it happened. Mm-hmm. That's the experience I had. You see? And the other thing, one of the reasons I can trust me more is because I'm aware of how I participated in that, even though I was in Holland when it happened. You treat a partner with automaticity, and they are going to get your attention. So most affairs, most people do need to realize, are communications. They have nothing to do with love.
Thomas, when you mention love, I'm sure you agree that both sides of love, that doesn't just mean, you know, being nicey-nicey to that person.
No, I'm not talking about placating people.
Yeah, I'm talking about being honest, being truthful. Yeah.
Being honest, being
and sometimes
truthful.
Sometimes that hurts another person.
Sometimes other people choose to be hurt by it.
Yeah.
However, I do want to share one thing, and this is my opinion, not a part of the workshop, but since we're on this subject, I believe the term tough love is a contradiction of terms. I do not believe in that phrase. I don't believe you can do that. I believe it is a phrase that people use when they want to make it look like they're loving and they're really saying, I cannot handle you, get out of my life. And I think it'd be better off for parents to be a little more honest than using, hiding behind tough love. That's my opinion. It's a contradiction of terms, as I understand love. Yes.
One of the things that I started to think while you were talking and the questions were coming up, is this love? Is this love when someone does that? And I think it's totally invisible. It's an internal process, and you can't tell by an action whether it means that that person is loving or not. You can only tell by the result whether or not there was love being expressed. And sometimes that result doesn't even become visible for quite a while.
It's not always immediate, no.
So you can't pin it down as a yes, this was loving, or no, this
right.
wasn't.
Yeah, one of the most loving things I saw my first teacher ever do was throw somebody out of the house and tell him never to come back. It transformed his life within a week. It didn't look loving at the time. Right. But you have to be an awful wise person to wave the double-edged sword of love. And Flaubert was a very wise person. She was a master teacher. She knew how to wave that sword around. Tom.
When I was a child, my parents taught me that love was sacrificing yourself. And for me, self-love says don't sacrifice yourself. The world taught me that love is a series of sacrificing people for different things. And that's wrong, too. So I just think of sacrifice.
Mm-hmm.
Wherever there's sacrifice, there isn't love. And isn't. Yeah. Isn't.
Yeah.
Jesus was wrong.
What do we got, Richard?
We're talking about a universal principle.
Right.
And it is a powerful energy. I recognize that we have unconscious ties with other people.
Mm-hmm.
When I change, those ties change.
Yes.
I went through a perfect marriage, and the divorce brought up everything unperfect that had been denied. My children were taught that they could not communicate with me. I was a pariah and off limits, so forth. I struggled with all of that for a good number of years, wanting to blame mother and all that. When I began to see that she was only expressing the unconscious content of what I felt about myself, and I took responsibility for that, it had nothing to do with changing her opinion of me, but accepting myself and being relaxed with whatever she felt about mm-hmm. me. That's her business, not my business.
Mm-hmm.
10 years, I worked with just changing my perception of self, seeing my former wife as being where I put my unconscious view of self. If that bothered me at all, it was unfinished business.
Mm-hmm.
My oldest daughter was not able to communicate with me, didn't want anything to do with me. When she left for college this September, she began to communicate with me. And I have received two letters that were incredible. I read the letter to Susan. Susan was crying. I said, Susan, you should be reading the letter to me. I should be crying. And we have had an incredible communication. Everything that I'm interested in, I find that it corresponds with her interests. And yet I am the father that she was denying. All that has changed is my perception of myself.
Uh-huh.
And like attracts like.
Exactly. Again, I want to restate this. Your partner can call you back to wholeness by doing the things you reacted to all the way through childhood into adulthood if you now start responding to that with love. That's what I'm saying. This workshop gets so simple that the trick is, how do you get people to go home and actually do this? Okay? As I shared in the Sunday service I did in relation to unconditional love, love is not a feeling. There are feelings that are a result of love. Love is something you express or something you do. And if you're not experiencing love in your relationship today, if you're not experiencing security, if you're not experiencing confidence, it's because you're not expressing it, period. It is not your partner's responsibility to give you a sense of being loved, being secure, and being confident, and being all right with yourself. Not only is it not their responsibility, if they even try to do that, you are going to resent them later. You with me? If you want to experience more love in your relationship, express more love. If you want to experience more trust, express more trust. If you want to experience more confidence, express more confidence. The universal law says if you give it, you'll receive it. So if I want to receive love, receive confidence, receive all these things, not necessarily from my partner, but from life, then I must express it. I experience what I express. Don't get caught in this thing of, I don't feel love for Mariana anymore. If I'm not feeling love for her, it's because I'm not loving her. Everybody got that? I do more sessions with couples who say, we don't feel love for each other anymore. What should we do? And I tell them, love each other. And they say, but you don't understand. We don't feel it. I know you don't. You're not expressing it. Start expressing it. And you'll feel it again. It's that simple. Yes.
This is in connection with something you were mentioning before. You were talking about people having an affair, being jealous, working through it, and so on. But you didn't mention something, no one mentioned something which is not as prevalent today. It was more prevalent in the 70s. This open marriage idea.
Yeah, the couple who thought of it got divorced,
what do you
too.
Think?
Literally.
I still was going to ask what the effect would that would be on a marriage. Would that be a good or a bad effect?
I can't answer that.
No cheating, no deception.
Yeah. I can't answer that. It's not my preference. Yeah, they did say it was right, and the very couple who created it are now saying, don't do it. It ruined our relationship. However, the bottom line is you're talking preference. It's just not, it wouldn't be a preference of mine to have that kind of relationship. But I'm not saying it's wrong. I don't believe it's a matter of being right or wrong. It will produce results, that's for sure. Yes.
Thomas, when you say, and I'm quoting you, so this will be an error, but you say just love each other or express love with each other. Now, that hits me wrong, because I think that the people are expressing something already,
mm-hmm.
and it's usually disappointment
mm-hmm.
or disapproval or something. Mm-hmm. Don't you have to acknowledge that first?
Yes. Yes. You don't have to acknowledge it first.
Or at least to admit you're doing it or get in touch with the fact that...
Right. Well, okay, we did...
Lots of people call disappointment love.
Right. Okay, back here in the other phases, or in the other phases here, I did talk a lot about you got to get honest, you got to admit, this is what I do, this is what I've been doing, or this is even what I want, which is, I haven't finished that part yet. What I am saying, this is my belief, no matter what I am going through, love can transform it.
Uh-huh.
No matter what it is.
It seems
love
like
is the most powerful transforming energy.
There's a fine line between loving and whitewashing things with love.
Agreed. I'm not suggesting that. I wouldn't call that love. I call it placating.
Okay.
That's the term I use for whitewashing the scenario. And I know a lot of couples who do it. And I'm not saying it's wrong either. Oh, everything's perfect. Everything's fine. And you can look at them and think, whoa, if that's considered perfect and fine, then what's this over here? What I am saying is that if we will express the love that we are, we will become healed. Our partner can call us into that, accidentally, even if you want to say, however, they're very well picked. to trigger us. We know they're going to trigger us. Are you? How many of us are aware of that? How many of us knew that if I get with this partner, I'm going to get all my lessons? You know, we know it when we pick our partner because we want the lessons. We want the opportunity to respond with love. Not meaning placating, not meaning whitewashing, and not excluding sitting down and being honest and clear with each other, which is another part of it. That's towards the right here at the end of this. The other point is we have every right to ask our partners for what we want. We're adults. We're grown up. We're allowed to say to our partner, this is what I want. This is what I would like. Now, if Mariana says no and I go feeling like a hurt puppy, that's my choice. But I have a right to ask. You see? We have a right to ask for what we want in our relationships.
By the way, in my relationship to Jesus, I didn't mean that you were wrong. I just meant that people have been wrong about you.
Yeah, we were. Everybody was going to keep a distance from you for a. The lightning will strike here. What do we got?
You've been using your own experience with Mariana as an example here, and I wanted to pursue that a little bit. It sounds to me like you had to do that which you were disinclined to do for a while to get to a healthy place. And knowing something intellectually, I mean, you can know in your gut that you're in a fear spot because you know you're in a hole and you're hunkered down and you're afraid to stick your head up because it's going to get shot off. And it's real hard when you're in that hole to think, okay, love, I'm going to stick my head up and everything's going to be fine. It's real hard to convince, I mean, your friends might all be up there cheering for you and they might be throwing ropes and ladders down and things like that, but you know, if you're convinced your ass is on the line and it's going to get blown away, it's real hard. And I wonder how you can take the knowing and transform it into the feeling. How can you actually get down into the nitty-gritty and do that work? And I wonder if you could use your experience with what you were describing as an example.
The answer to your question is going to sound like a trick answer. The only way you can learn something is to experience it. And that's why I was saying, if you don't take this information home and work with it, you won't get the magic that happens. What I had the things I had to deal with, number one was my fears of a lack of self-worth. That wasn't as hard as what I had to deal with was changing some core beliefs. And what that required was to look at the situation differently and look at the future differently and to step out there and respond. And it took me 6 months to get up the nerve to step out there and respond. Once I did, I realized I could have stepped out there within an hour, within 2 minutes of getting the lesson, quote unquote, if you will. You see? The thing that I also want to point out is for 6 months, I failed that lesson. Does everybody, you know, be careful with, I watch in the seminary group and I hear, you know, this happens and then this happens over here. And then I start hearing in this program, well, that was a good lesson for everybody. It was a missed opportunity from everyone I've noticed so far. People have missed the opportunity to get the lesson. Understand the difference. All right? Know the difference between an opportunity to learn a lesson and failing the opportunity, which means it's going to come back. Don't kid yourself. Don't take a situation in your life and use New Age jargon and say, oh, that was a good lesson for everybody involved. It was a failed opportunity for everybody involved. Now let's get down to where when the lesson comes up, I know the appropriate response. Is everybody with me on that? Don't kid yourself about that kind of stuff. I failed the opportunity for 6 straight months. And then for a year or two after I did get through it, I caught myself a couple times looking for the missile. You know, and realizing I didn't fully drop it until I decided one day to get rid of the missile. It is not one I can throw. And that I will explain when we get into the part of this workshop on forgiveness. If you've truly forgiven, there's nothing to be remembered. People say, I can forgive, but I can't forget. That's a lie that's closest to the truth. If you've forgiven, there's nothing to be remembered. And that's true freedom, by the way. Forgiveness brings peace. Yes, behind you, Richard.
when I don't feel love, that's really another way of saying I'm not getting my needs met, my expectations mm-hmm. being met. That's my problem. I'm not loving myself. It has nothing to do with my partner. I think that's what you were getting at when you talked about, be love or express love.
Right.
It has nothing to do with your needs. It's bringing something from within yourself.
And bringing it out and expressing it.
Yeah. Which might be the most loving thing I can express is I feel a void inside.
Mm-hmm.
I feel lonely. I feel that I can't love. I start with that. That can be the most loving expression that I can share because I'm sharing my vulnerability.
Right. Well, you know, one thing to know in your relationships, where the figure comes from is not important. If you are triggered by your partner or anybody for that matter, and your reaction lasts over 3 to 5 minutes, you're dealing with a childhood experience, not the experience in the now. Really get that. It has nothing to do with now. If it turns into one of those ongoing, escalating experiences, and you're thinking, well, I'm doing this because of what Sharon just said to me, no. I can resolve what Sharon said to me in 5 seconds. If it starts bringing it up and out of me, what it's bringing up and out of me is a past experience I never worked through. Yes. Okay. All right. Great. We don't need excuses to get out of a relationship, and we don't need excuses to get in one. Does everybody get that? We don't need excuses to get out, and we don't need excuses to get in. My point is this. If you're in a relationship and you want out, get out. You don't have to gather all the negative things and reasons about your partner that you're going to put on a platter and shove in their face to say, these are the reasons, these are the excuses for why I need out of this marriage. If you want out, step out. Get out. If you want in, get in. You don't have to gather an arsenal of weapons to justify ending a relationship. Does everybody get me with that? It is so common when couples decide that they just really don't want to be together. Then that is the trigger mechanism for let's gather our weapons, let's, you know, political stuff, let's get down and dirty and throw mud on each other so I can prove to the world that I'm justified in getting out of this relationship. If you want out, get out. And if you got a relationship you want to get into, get in. You see? The answer to the one question asked earlier is not a way of avoiding the question. If you want to experience the power of this workshop, just do it. Just start responding with love and find out how transformational love is. If you need reasons for responding with love, if you need excuses for responding with love, if you're going to wait until the stage of love is set, I want to give you one good warning. It will never be that way. The stage of love is set when you just start loving. Yes.
It's so easy, I think, to say just respond with love. I think what I need is a little direction. What does that exactly mean?
Being kind, even when the person is expressing pain in your direction. It means caring enough to keep love alive in the relationship. It means caring enough to transform your life, which is the only one you can transform, by the way, not transforming your partner. All right? It means a lot of the things. If you want to get down more to what exactly are we talking about, one of the ways to do that is go back to your romantic phase. What are the things you were so willing to do for your partner when you were in romantic phase? And why are we no longer willing to do it anymore? You know, I meet with couples, and for example, I'll have a husband tell me why my wife demands too much of me. And I'm getting this image of she's trying to make him paint their house lime green. She wants him to blow up the garage or kill the children, you know. And then I call the wife into the session and I say, what are these demands that you demand so much of your husband? I want a hug. I want a kiss. I want a phone call. I want cards. I want flowers. You following me? It's all the stuff we used to do automatically in romantic phase. If we will bring that over to transformational love, it's not an altered state of consciousness. Our feet are on the ground, and I choose to love my partner and stop blaming my partner for my pain. And you can prove that to yourself. If you think your partner is causing you pain, get rid of your partner and get another one and find out how quick that partner causes you pain. You see? You can't fix your pain by changing your partner. You fix your pain by deciding, I've had enough of this. All right? I want to talk quick about forgiveness, and then we're going to do a forgiveness meditation exercise. The first point I want to make about forgiveness, only you have the power to release your past. Only you have the power to release your past. Or, to say that another way, forgiveness is for self, not for the other person. It's something we do to release our past. Whatever I will not forgive is stuck in my life, and I am dragging it through my life. And there's something I want you to know about forgiveness. If you want to bond yourself to somebody, universally bond yourself to somebody, then pick a person who did something to you that you thought was inappropriate and refuse to forgive them. And you will follow that soul through this universe and through sojourns and through the universe and through sojourns until you forgive the person. I'm very serious about that. Edgar Cayce did a fascinating reading on it. I don't want to paraphrase his reading. The principle is love is bonding and a lack of forgiveness is bonding. And the best way to glue yourself to somebody you hate is refuse to forgive them, no matter what they did. And I'm saying no matter what happened. If you want to be stuck with that person for the rest of your life, in your consciousness, refuse to forgive them, and you'll take it to your grave, not theirs. Everybody getting that? You'll take it to your grave, not theirs. Forgiveness is not using the past to create the future. Forgiveness is not using the past to create the future. Well, I can forgive Mariana, and I'll watch out for this for the rest of my life. That's not forgiveness. You with me? If you've truly forgiven, you will experience peace, and you will forget what it was that you couldn't forgive. And I don't care what it is. Forgiveness is powerful. If you can recognize it has nothing to do with the other person. I forgive, so I am free to live my life fully now. You may want to take another homework assignment, which is, what are the things that you refuse to let go of and forgive in your life? You're chained to it, and you're dragging it through your life. It is not dragging you. You're dragging it. Really get clear on that principle. I hear people talk about, I had this tragic experience as a child or as a young adult, and now I'm chained to it. You're not chained to it. You've got it chained to you, and you're the only one who can let go. Yes.
Thomas, I've been doing a lot of looking at this lately, and I find the only things I can't forgive are the things I have to forgive myself for.
Very good.
That seems so much harder to forgive myself than it is to forgive my parents or anybody else.
I agree with that. Yes. Part of what will help that is the know thyself awakening stage. Because as you really get honest and start looking at yourself, you discover, yes, I've done some pretty horrible things. You also start discovering, I've done some pretty wonderful things too. I am a pretty amazing being from many perspectives. Our life force energy is stuck in our lack of forgiveness. This is very real. It literally gets stuck, and you have less and less life force energy. So forgiveness is a person who is a forgiving person is a person who wants to live their life now, not in the past. Yes. I can't take a whole lot of questions, or I'm not going to get finished. It's for all of us.
Get reincarnated again and you haven't forgiven somebody, it doesn't necessarily have to be the same person that you're, it can be the same person with the same problem maybe, but it wouldn't necessarily have to be the same problem to work out your karma.
Not necessarily. Edgar Cayce did say in a reading that you can bond yourself to another soul with lack of forgiveness, with refusing to resolve or release the experience.
I mean, you could work out the problem with somebody else.
Possibly.
No. It doesn't have to be.
It could be. If the lack of forgiveness is powerful enough, Edgar Cayce says it will be. His reading went as far as to say, the reading described identical twins born who were stuck together, inseparable physically, who were two souls who had a tragic situation and refused to forgive each other. And it was such a bonding lack of forgiveness that they came back bonded together with the ultimate challenge of you are stuck to this until you drop it, is what it boils down to. And he's got a whole reading on it, and I shouldn't be paraphrasing his readings. I should have brought it. But my point is, a lack of forgiveness will bond you to the situation, and you drag it through your life. I can forgive and I can't forget is a lie. All right? There's no such thing. Forgiveness is letting go of the situation. One of the reasons we don't forgive, you may want to get this in your notes, one of the reasons we don't forgive is because we want to deny what is. It's an attempt to deny what is. Less.
Yeah, I've had a lot of work to do on forgiveness over the last few years, and in the end, the main thing that I realized, I had an experience where I saw energy bleeding away from the aura, and it really hit me so powerful that the only reason we can't experience freedom and enlightenment is because our energy is zapping off all over the place to all these people. And in the end, you're going to have to do it anyway.
All the unresolved scenarios, right.
You know, you're only putting off your own enlightenment by not forgiving.
One of the things you may want to know is if you live in a right-wrong world, true forgiveness is almost impossible. Is everybody with me on that? If you're in this right-wrong world and what this person did to me is wrong and I'm right and I'm going to forgive them, that's a power trip. Everybody, how many people in here have not had the power trip forgiveness experience? It goes something like this. After a long, drawn-out scenario, I finally walk up to the person and ask for forgiveness, and the person looks at me as if they don't know what I'm talking about. And now I got two things I got to forgive them for. One is what I thought they originally did, and the other one is not remembering that they did something to me that they need to be forgiven for. Don't get caught in the power trip of forgiveness. Don't play that game. It's the game of playing the game of forgiving each other. Forgiveness is something we do for ourselves. I am not saying that it is inappropriate. If a person comes to you and says, will you forgive me for this? Obviously, you want to say yes. Obviously. My point, though, is forgiveness works with self, not with the other person. It frees me. And being a forgiving person does not make you a good person. It does not make you holy. It does not make you spiritual. It does make you free to live your life fully now. Joseph.
So what you say right there is If you forgive somebody, you forget what they have done.
Exactly.
Wiped right from your mind. Totally.
If you truly forgive, you will forget. You will wipe the slate clean. Okay? But again, it's for self. I forgive to free myself. I may not even have to go to the person and tell them I just had a forgiving experience. You may want to. You may kill it by trying. It is something you do with yourself to release the past and catch up to now. And as far as one other principle that comes up when I do the forgiveness workshop is, he doesn't deserve to be forgiven. That may be absolutely, totally correct. You deserve to be free. So it is not a matter of if the crime deserves forgiveness. That's not the point of true forgiveness. And I don't care if we're talking murder, rape, whatever we're talking. The question is not, does he or she deserve forgiveness? The question is, I deserve to be free. I don't need to drag this through my life, no matter what it was.
In some ways, it's been my experience and also my belief that if you want to know if you have forgiven, you will know it because the other person will have forgiven you.
Right. There's peace in it. Yeah. True forgiveness can bond you to a person you thought you absolutely, totally hated and were disgusted with. True forgiveness. Because, again, true forgiveness works with self. It doesn't make me right. It doesn't make me holy. It doesn't even make me spiritual. It does give me freedom. Do we have a question here?
What if the thing that you want to forgive for, and if you forget it, it would really be bad if you did, because of certain things, sometimes you can't forgive, because sometimes they'll start all over again with certain people. Sometimes those people don't change.
It can only start all over again if you're available for it to start all over again. Does everybody understand what I just said there about this? That's using forgiveness to create the future. I can forgive, but I've got to watch out and make sure it doesn't happen to me again. It can't happen if I'm not available. You've never had an experience you did not make yourself available to have. This is a cause-effect universe. You can say it's unfair. Fairness doesn't apply. The question has no value if it's fair or not. You can't talk fairness in a cause-effect universe. What is, is. You see? So if you don't want to have an experience that you had in the past, don't make yourself available for those kind of experiences. You see? Does that make sense on how that works? If you've got a tragic experience you want to forgive, review it once in the mind, not in the solar plexus. Review it. See it for what it is. Drop it, turn your consciousness someplace else. Does everybody follow that? Review it once in the mind, not in the emotions, because you'll start reliving the whole damn thing. Review it once in the mind, call it what it is, drop it, turn your consciousness someplace else. That's a process for forgiveness, if you will. But it's review it in the mind, not in the emotional body. And then just drop it and move your consciousness to where you want your consciousness to be, because where your consciousness is what is expanding in your life. What you dwell on expands. If you dwell on your pain expands. If you dwell on your hurts expand. If you dwell on being vulnerable and taken advantage of, you are making yourself vulnerable and in a position to be taken advantage of. We create our experiences of life, and we create the opportunity to heal those experiences. We're creating it from both sides. And we've created some very loving scenarios, and we've created some very painful scenarios. And the truth on them will set us free. So, forgiveness is for self. Karmic debt is for self. This workshop is for self. Work is that which I am disinclined to do. If you are disinclined to tell your wife every morning that she is your princess and you recognize the gold that she offers you, then tell her that. You with me? That's one of the things I suggest in the relationship workshop. The first thing you should tell your partner every morning is how important and special they are in your life, and it's the last thing you tell them at night when you go to bed. I appreciate the value of this relationship. I appreciate the gold. I appreciate the pain. I appreciate this whole relationship. I appreciate you for just being you. All right? The point I'm trying to make again is it's a just do it concept. If you just start doing it, then you're doing it. It's happening. If you keep waiting for the right time never comes. All right? The right time to love never comes. The time to love is now, in the moment, no matter what's going on. And if your partner's in pain, it's even more reason to be loving them. If your partner's hurting, if your partner's insecure, love them. I don't mean placate them. I don't mean buy into their shit, treat shit like shit, because it is what it is. And treat the real thing like the real thing. So love the love that is in your partner. Have that kind of relationship. Yes?
You go up to the person and say, I appreciate you hurting me? Well, that's just about what you're I mean, I can't imagine anybody saying that.
Well, try it and see what happens.
Do you really mean that?
Yeah. If you think a person, first of all, if you think a person did hurt you, and you're not clear if they did or if it's just your choice, walk up to the person, very honestly, look them right in the eye and say, I appreciate that experience. And if you're honest about it and you look them right in the eye, it is unlikely they will ever do that with you again. They may go do it with somebody else, but it is not likely they would choose you next time. Because you're telling them, I am not available for that. I see what's going on. And I appreciate the opportunity to have the experience. You see? It worked for me. In the scenario I was describing earlier, the big lesson I had, you know, the person I had to sit down and get clear with was the third person. And when I finally thanked him for the opportunities he created in my life, the situation was over. You see? I could have blamed him. I could have accused him. I could have done all kinds of things. All right? But I just would have got it back anyway. Okay? At least twice a day, look your partner in the eye, see living love looking back at you, acknowledge that experience, and just love. And with that, I'm going to turn it over to Stephen for a meditation exercise.
This is not going to be taped. This is an experience. You've been thinking a lot.
Positive. It depends on your perception of it.
They backed me up when I was rebelling the school system.
Support.
My father always lent me the car.
Support.
My father taught me boundaries, and my mother taught me when they were, when it was possible to exceed them.
Great.
When it was appropriate to exceed them.
Great. That's the real positive one. Boundaries. This relationship workshop doesn't deal a lot with children. As we said, this is a workshop for self, and one of the most quote-unquote confusing thing for a child is not to know where the boundaries are, or to have the boundaries constantly changed. Our dad sets one set of boundaries and mom sets another.
We were praised in front of others.
Great. All right.
I had a sense of deep, deep roots.
Great roots, absolutely. Very important.
And I have to share that I'm sitting here getting really teary because I fell in love with my parents some years ago. And this is really bringing it back strongly again when I realized all of this many, many years ago that it wasn't all the negatives I had thought I had all those years, but
right.
I really got the positive parts, and it feels real good to sit here and feel all that really coming up again.
That's great. I always like to share with people, if you made it to this workshop, your parents did their job quite well. Literally. Yes.
Yeah, I would underline that. And for whatever else I may have said about my parents, they have changed and grown over the years, and they're in their 80s now. And just a few years ago, my mother, at 70-odd years of age, opened up a bed and breakfast.
All
and
right.
It absolutely rejuvenated her life and made everything come together for her. And in a wonderfully positive sense, she gave me a whole new model for the way one can live a life.
Great.
It so never, she still never stopped teaching. Growing.
Absolutely. Parents are initiators and teachers. Have you discovered that yet? They'll initiate you in the things you don't want to be initiated in, and they will teach you the things you want to learn. Yes.
I want to say that the lacks in my life were my great teachers.
The what?
The lacks.
The lacks.
Yes. The absence of things.
Oh,
of
okay.
Parents,
right.
Et cetera.
Right.
My upbringing was there was a duality with regard to a great number of insecurities, but there was a constancy in the home with being there, my family being all together, my parents being together, and so there was a base from which I could sort of reach out.
Right, foundation. Roots and foundation is very important, in my opinion, for people. I think it's a tragedy when we uproot cultures' roots and try to teach them a new religion and stuff. We yank them out of their roots. Yes.
My father taught me that it was okay to be earthy. It was a good thing to be earthy, in fact.
Great.
Earthy. He cussed and drank. Blamed you.
Marilyn brought up that this made her feel good because it was bringing up warm feelings and so on. And I didn't say it in the last page, but every time I want to talk about childhood, I know I'm going to cry. And I was going to ask you, because you brought up in the earlier session that if we go back through something, or a therapist who asks you to do that is the other thing, that's not a good way of learning love or healing. And yet I feel like I have like about a month or so of uncried grief or untaken care of grief. I cannot talk about my childhood without, you know,
right,
going into tears. So I don't know, I guess my question is, what about that part of it? I didn't really fall in love with them.
Yeah.
Sure.
Well, let me respond to that from two perspectives. One perspective is what I was sharing this morning is you can't get rid of it by reliving it. And stop and think about it. I mean, think about it, and the question will answer itself. The other thing I was sharing is pain does not get rid of pain. So if you have a painful situation in your life, you don't want to use pain to fix it. Having said that, let me also say that the most healing experience a human being can have is crying. Because they have discovered scientifically that if you cry all the way through the experience, not part of it, to the conclusion, the tears change their chemical makeup at the end of the crying experience, and they are literally healing. Now, this is a scientific discovery, that a tear at the end of a crying experience has the power to heal the physical body, in the emotional body. So I hope that doesn't sound like a contradiction. What I was saying is that to relive it is to relive it. So some of the therapy techniques of reliving put it back in. You get it out, but you also put it back in the very experience. And the other point to be made, although this isn't a workshop on therapy stuff, they've done some research. Remember the Gestalt beating the pillow scenario that was big in the 60s and 70s? They've done some research in the last year or two and discovered that the people who really got into that theory are still beating the pillows. It becomes addictive. And every time I have to get something out, I have to go get a pillow and beat it. Or I have to primal. Well, the word primal by definition means one time. So have a good primal, have a good rebirthing, have a good healing, crying experience from childhood, and then drop it, especially if it's painful. Okay? Because pain doesn't heal pain. Yes.
One of the things that I've used over the years that I think have been real effective is that you can change your mind about all these things.
Exactly.
And what I've done over and over again in many different workshops and using NLP techniques and things is to take situations that were painful and change them in my mind to where they came out the way I needed them to be. And through that process, what I began to realize is that what I had been holding was only the way I saw it.
Good point.
And that it was not necessarily the way it really was. And that maybe even if it was the way I really saw it, they really didn't know what they were doing. And that's really where I have to say most of my forgiveness has come from. And I have to share that it's been the most wonderful experience in the last couple of years. My mother almost died 2 years ago. Really, they had to call the doctor into the room twice. We went through quite a summer. And she transformed through that experience. And for the first time, my mother, every time I talk to her, tells me how much she loves me and how sorry she is that she, if she ever did anything to hurt me. It's the kind of words I waited for when I was young, and I hear it all the time now. It's just the most healing experience. It's wonderful. But you can change your mind about your experiences.
Yes.
My mother always used to say, don't cry too long, you'll make yourself sick.
You know, this thing about crying is, it's real important as a parent to understand this principle, to allow your children to cry through an experience. However, there's something you want to know about that technique. If you haven't done it as a parent, you will not allow your child to have the experience, because you will bring up your own pain, and you'll have to stop the child to stop your own pain. And that's why we stop our children from those completed crying experiences, because it brings up in us our incomplete experiences. Okay? I don't want to get too far into all that, because we'll get off track, but it's important to know that. It can be very difficult as a parent to let a child cry to completion. We will bribe our children to stop crying. I'm holding you now, you can stop, here's a sucker, here's gum, anything to get them to stop it, because it's surfacing the same stuff in us. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
John Hello? Yeah. John Bradshaw has a workshop where he put a person in the center of chairs, and the people surrounding the one in the chair will just say affirming things. Welcome to the world. Mm-hmm. We love you. We're going to take care of you. We're going to nurture you. These affirmations were never heard with birth and childhood. And it's amazing how it touches the person, and they get in touch with that absence mm-hmm. of that affirmation and support.
Right.
It's quite a catharsis for them.
Okay, we got any more on this particular question that we're answering here on the paper?
Well, what I was thinking was, one of the best experiences I've had was at expansion training up in Maryland with, never mind, it's not important, but what they do is they have like four or five people on each side of a person, and they put their arms together, and then they lean that person back and rock them, and it feels like it's totally supported. It feels mm-hmm. great.
All right. Okay, let's move on to the next question. The next page? Is that the way this is going to work? Okay, the question I want you to answer is, think about what you wanted and needed most as a child, your heart's desire. I don't know if that follows in sequence, but make sure that that's the page you're on right now. Number three is, think about what you wanted and needed most as a child, your heart's desire. All right? Love, kindness, caring, information, being heard, being respected. What did we want most as a child? And you got to get back into childhood to remember this.
It might sound silly, but I have a feeling that I was pretty happy as a child.
Pretty what?
Happy.
Happy.
And if I look back now, I can see a lot of things which might have been different. But as a child, I was quite happy.
Okay.
And there were certain incidents, like with my sister, that I would have wanted different. But in general, I think I was pretty happy at that time. Seriously.
Yeah, you didn't have any wants?
I really have to think about it.
Okay. Yes.
A bed.
A bed?
One house, one family, roots, consistency, and love.
Okay, great.
Freedom and acceptance of thought.
Okay, freedom and acceptance of thought.
I wanted my father not to come home.
Which means?
I was afraid of him.
Okay. So I wanted peace?
He was scary. Yeah.
Okay.
I wanted my mother's attention, affection, and love. She was really not there. I wanted pink fuzzy slippers like my girlfriend had and a big box of Crayolas like she had. And I wanted her mother also.
Because her mother cared? Okay, so I wanted to be taken care of, is what you want to get written down there.
I wanted not to be terrified of everything in the whole wide world except cats.
Okay, I wanted peace. Yes.
I was the youngest child, and I always felt left out or left behind, and I always wanted to feel a part of it. And I always wanted to feel on the inside of things rather than I was trying to scrabble around on the outside trying to get in.
Okay. I want to be a part. I want to be included.
Similar to what you wanted, I wanted brothers and sisters so that I could be included in a family because I was an only child and didn't
companionship.
Didn't have any
peer companionship.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
This is not nearly as profound as what most people have said, but some people might have an unprofound desire. I wanted motorized transportation. I wanted a go-kart or a motor scooter, desperately.
Mm-hmm.
Well, yeah, 7, 8, 9, 10.
I must be talking too much because it was in my mind and out of it. Oh, yeah, I had a sister and brother, and they were my total loving support system, but I wanted to be able to protect them, and I couldn't. I was the youngest.
Okay. Joseph?
Yeah, I wanted to be appreciated for who I was and not compared to somebody else.
Okay. So I wanted to be appreciated.
I wanted to be felt important, wanted a father, which I didn't have, and a mother that was home, which he always had a wife.
Okay.
I wanted my parents to hold me and use words of endearment, which they never did.
Okay.
And I wanted to be allowed to express myself.
Mm-hmm.
And I wanted them to care, to know what I cared about. Family holidays,
mm-hmm.
which we never had, and for my parents to plan for me instead of allowing me to plan for myself, including my schooling from the age of 8,
mm-hmm.
which I did for myself.
All right.
I wanted to be, is this one?
Go ahead.
Okay, I wanted to be successful in all that I could do, and I wanted to be perfect.
Okay.
I wanted to be grown up, doing all right. things that the
That's
grown
a good
ups
one.
Did.
I wanted to be grown up, which implies freedom, numerous other things. Yeah, sex.
I wanted to experience as much life as possible, not be confined and restricted.
Okay. I wanted to be free. It's a biggie.
I didn't have anybody to appreciate my accomplishments, and I did so well considering.
Who's ever comment it was about the go-kart, was it? It reminded me of how badly, how desperately I wanted my driver's license from the time I was about 13.
Right.
And that reminds me now of how desperately I wanted to feel autonomous and to feel the reward and punishment system of my own life in effect, that I was responsible.
So I wanted responsibility.
I never really felt that I was responsible or accountable. And I can see how this is, you know, still ticking around in there someplace. Yeah.
Feeling responsible and accountable is very universal. You know, they did a survey of the presidents and chairmen of the boards of the top 500 companies in the United States. And overwhelmingly, the response they got by the type of questions they asked these CEOs, males and females, was most of them believed they had fooled people to get where they are. Do you understand the principle? And that's fairly universal inside of most people. We don't really believe we deserve valid praise and so on and so forth. And we think we're fooling the world and fooling ourselves. That was a fascinating survey. Over 80% of the CEOs felt they had fooled their way to the top. Isn't that interesting? Didn't claim their achievements. Yes.
I wanted to believe in God, and instead of being afraid of him.
I wanted a loving source.
I really
source.
Wanted a connection with this God that everybody told me about, but the way they told me about him, he didn't sound like a very good friend of mine.
That's a good one.
So I found it very hard to believe.
A loving source, a loving God, or a loving authority figure.
He was going to punish me if I French kissed a boy. I'm kidding you not. I was going to go to hell. Now, how was I supposed to believe in him?
Right.
They taught me, the Holy Ghost Fathers from Ireland taught me how to hold my girlfriend.
You want a demonstration?
Yeah. They said, never, ever do this. Turn around for a second. Never, ever hold your girlfriend like this. Ever. Always stand beside her. And be a gentleman. Never touch her.
And definitely don't masturbate.
What does that mean?
I got in a serious trouble in a Catholic school one time when they were teaching us in class that if you masturbated, it was a mortal sin and you would go to hell. We argued that for about an hour and a half until they told me to sit down and shut up. I kept telling them that can't be true, you know, and we went around and around.
You were in heaven.
Yeah. Actually, I didn't know what the word meant. I just knew it couldn't be that way.
Do you want to know what the definition of boredom is?
What's
when you're masturbating and your hand falls asleep.
That was
you want to give you
temperance.
A name, please? The dirty joke session is at the end of the workshop. Masturbation, definition, ultimate act of self-love and self-worth.
What?
Ultimate act of self-love and self-worth. Definition of masturbation.
Same
huh? Yeah, you didn't know you loved yourself that much, did you? Masturbation, the definition, ultimate act of self-love and self-worth. Okay. How many people have masturbation down as a positive memory from childhood? All right. What we wanted and needed most as a child, some more examples of that, other than masturbating. Peter. Is there anybody in here who didn't masturbate as a child? Would you admit it if it's true?
I wanted to be nurtured.
Nurtured?
To be touched more, to
touched
be loved.
More?
I wanted less responsibility.
Less responsibility.
And I wanted honesty.
Honesty. Great.
Because a lot of times I felt that I knew what was going on, but they were not going to tell me.
Mm-hmm. That's the biggie.
Hello?
Yeah.
I want to, something I always feel, I want to be loved by my parents unconditionally, you know.
Okay.
I always have to do something, or the, you know, or act some way to be loved, approved. Mm-hmm. If not, I will always be left out.
Unconditional yeah. love
unconditional
from parents.
Love, yeah.
Right. Yes. Right. Yeah, that, yeah.
The true story of how we got here and the planet and the everything, all the
right.
questions. I just wanted the truth.
I wanted truth. Oh, that's the same principle I was sharing earlier. We want information as children,
yeah.
and we still do as adults. Information is a biggie for people.
I wanted to know that when I walked into the house every day, the same person was going to be there, because I never really knew whether my mother was going to be in a good mood or whether she was going to be a raging maniac.
I wanted a consistent relationship.
Yeah, right.
Consistent relationship. Behind you, you can pass it back to Richard there.
I wanted to be an Indian.
All right. In what does an Indian mean? Is that freedom or? So I wanted to be independent. Okay.
I wanted to know who I was.
Okay.
I was never told or shown in any way who I was.
All right, I wanted to know who I am.
I wanted all dogs to be friendly. We had some mean dogs in our neighborhood.
What's behind that, though? What's the word? I wanted...
Trust? I wanted the world to be safer.
I wanted the world to be safer. Okay.
Yeah.
I wanted safety. Great.
I wanted a best friend completely identical to me. Someone I could really relate to.
All right. I wanted somebody I could really relate to. I had an identical twin. So that's interesting. I wanted to get rid of him.
I wanted to have sisters, you know, that were close in age, because I had a sister 11 years older than me, and then I went 7.
Okay. Companionship.
Yeah.
I remember wanting my own identity. My mother used to dress us in the same clothes. And we were so identical that we could switch classes and the teacher couldn't tell. Literally. Identical twin. We still are identical other than my hand. Seriously. We're still identical twins. And he's got an eye missing. But you can't tell. He's got a glass eye.
Is he the one that's doing this morning?
Yeah. Actually, he's here now. Did you have something, Richard?
Oh, I had some.
Or David, go ahead.
I wanted to know why I was born, why I was alive, and why I would die.
Information. That's what I call that. We want information.
Yeah.
Or we want to know why. Okay. Mel?
I didn't want anything like that at all. I just wanted to be a hobo and a bank robber and that kind of person.
Independence and freedom.
Yes. Uh-huh.
Independence and freedom.
I think in wanting to be an Indian, I really wanted my imagination to be validated.
Okay, great. I wanted my imagination to be validated. That's a good one. That's good.
I just wanted to live without fear.
All right. I wanted peace. We need to translate these. You don't want to write on the page, I wanted to live without fear, because this is what did I want, so I wanted peace. Is everybody clear about what we're putting on the paper? You can put both, but yes.
Yeah, Richard said just now. Yeah, it really hit me just then that I wanted to stay in the fantasy when I lived in the woods. You know, being Robin Hood and Indians and all that sort of thing.
Right.
I wanted to really get into that.
Right.
And stay there.
I want to validate my imagination or validate my fantasies. Or I wanted to create my own world.
I wanted to be happy all the time.
You wanted to be happy all the time. Yes.
I wanted to be recognized.
Okay.
I wanted recognition. I wanted to live without anxiety.
All right? I wanted freedom or space.
I remember I always wanted a puppy and I never had one, but what I'm getting as I sit here is that I wanted something so much to connect to.
Okay.
Was what I really wanted.
All right. Right next to you there. Tom?
I wanted to be weightless.
And that means?
I don't know. I just thought of it when people were about their imagination, but it was, I would watch these space shows where these guys would be weightless, and I thought if I could breathe underwater, I'd be weightless.
Did you try it?
I wanted not to be Jewish, and I'll tell you why. Because I felt very left out of the Christian world that I lived in, where people celebrated Christmas and had wonderful holidays.
Okay.
And I put Christmas stockings up one year, and nobody filled them.
Yeah.
And it was a total drag.
So I wanted to belong to my peers? Or
It's very strange being Jewish in a Christian country, whatever that means.
I wanted to be Jewish.
Well, no, I'm everything, so.
Yeah. Okay, if we got enough there, let's move on to the next question, which is the next. Okay, we want to think about positive memories from childhood, but let me instruct you on the answer. What we're talking about here in this question is trying to remember positive experiences. For example, when I answered this question, the first thing I remembered was the first time my parents bought me a brand new bicycle. What you write on the paper is not bicycle. What you write is how you felt about that positive memory. I felt free, I felt grown up. I can to this day remember going down the driveway and down the sidewalk in this brand new red bicycle, feeling free and grown up. So free and grown up is what we put on the paper. You will get that from remembering some positive memories. Some examples. The first time you were allowed to stay out after dark, how did you feel? The first time you were allowed to stay out all night, how did you feel? The first time your parents bought you your own dog or your own cat or your own horse, how did that make you feel? We want the feelings on paper. If you're a woman, the first time you were allowed to wear makeup, the first time you were allowed to get dressed up, the first time you were allowed to be left home alone, how did you feel? I felt mature, I felt confident, I felt what? Positive memories now. If it's a negative one, drop it. We want positive. Okay? And then some examples. Great.
I got Kanga and Roo for Christmas, even though I was Jewish.